then you're starting to make mistakes, because the standard build is 3 Dark Seals, Righteous Glory, Randuin's Omen. He may just change the build to try and have some armor earlier to not die, and then he may actually start team fighting anyway and getting people away from his carries. That's the important part.
Actually peeling for the damage dealers in there. And the other question is, how is SOFM actually going to build this game as like Kha'Zix? Will he go for that W evolve first? Will he just go for additional Kha'Zix build? Or will that change depending on how the early game goes for him? We're about to find out as we get into game four. Game one in this best of three between Aimee and Snake. It will be our first best of three today. We have another one coming up for you later on, which Frostgurren will be rejoining us for. But for now, we get to see some T-Tours as we take a look around the Summoner's Rift, and it will be that Earth Dragon, that Mountain Dragon, as the first one to start us off. And here we are, Jin Zhao dancing in the bot lane, and SOFM chilling in the jungle, just emoting a little bit. I wish I knew what he was saying, because if I knew a little bit of Mandarin, I assume it's probably the same in English. It's just a direct translation.
Yeah, I'd imagine it would be as well. I'm glad that you mentioned the junglers as well coming into this game, because Ben 4 against SOFM is definitely a feature matchup. Very conflicting styles, as we've alluded towards already. Ben 4 definitely kill hungry. SOFM always looking for the farm and then utilizing that farm to get advantages and then pushing with that advantage to get even more on the map. So we have to see if Lee Sin can get it going early, or if SOFM is going to be able to run away with the farm game, get level 6 and start bopping people.
Question is, will it actually revolve around the junglers here, or will it revolve around the top lane where you have a Darius who can very quickly get out of control, especially with a Lee Sin getting involved and just actually keeping SOFM out of his lane?
Whoa, that's dangerous,
the wall from Ben 4, especially as he's cutting into the bus. He's isolated away from that one. Amazing J with the Q, and he's just straight up dead. First blood over to SOFM. Amazing J trying to get max stacks there on SOFM, but he's only on 4, and now he's unfortunately away from the team. Flandre unable to finish him off, despite Amazing J not catching him in the outer ring of that Decimate, but still, first blood to Snake from a very risky invade from Ben 4.
We talk about bloodthirsty against farm heavy, that's exactly what we just saw at level 1. These two, I mean, Amazing J and Ben 4, it does make sense, their 2v2 is quite adequate, but if you're going to jump over a wall like that to red buff and not check if they're there, that's your only spell as Lee Sin now wasted. And you will start to get pushed out of that extremely quickly to what isolated damage a Kha'Zix can offer. SOFM's now just massively snowballed as long as he doesn't die to blue.
Yeah, SOFM has now become a kill jungler because Ben 4 just suicided into him. Rode uses the hookshot, lands onto FM. He's taken damage from the blue buff as well. Lands the tactical sweep. Onto attack for the kill. Kill return. Moe's going to find him. Level 2 versus level 2.
But
it's a portal combat. Is the LPL rusty?
This has just quickly become a complete mess. Rode now goes back bottom lane with a red buff in level 2. No summoners available for him, but it doesn't matter because he's just so large now. Camille gets a kill, and that is the biggest thing. Ben 4 and Rode always work in tandem when they're moving around Summoner's Rift, and they actually take out SOFM and eradicate the lead that he had already forged.
So something I was going to say in this game as we got later on was just like, okay, we're going to see a Camille game where she doesn't get an early kill, and then we'll actually see how she does through the rest of the game instead of snowballing like she did in LCS. However, Rode just picked up a kill, so he's looking for another one, or at least to just annoy SOFM. Mo has read this. He's going to be chilling with his jungler so he doesn't get destroyed once again. But it does mean that Mint will be down there by himself as Rode gets to go into the enemy jungle, gets to put down that aggressive vision, and just look for roams into the mid lane.
No, when explosive plants are around, Camille exists, these ganks.
Tank just like, why is there a Camille on my lane? Tactical sweep comes down, so much damage from the Q, and Athena just coming in and chiming in with a phosphorus bomb. SOFM waiting in the bush, that will be isolated damage onto Rode. Got a follow from Victor as well. There is no flash, and the red buff may go back to SOFM. No, it's over to Tank. This one's mine, he'll get that health regen, and that'll be a kill back over them. So that's a 1-1-0 Rode. What are you doing?
We're playing past the parcel, I think, and red buff is the parcel at the moment. Eventually we'll see where it lands, but at the moment this lucky dip of buffs are just completely moving around. It's Tank's turn to die, I'd imagine, the next minute.
You get a buff, mid lane gets red buff. Okay, Ben 4 looking for a gank into the top lane. Flandre will see him as he was going into the top side of the map as signaled by his mid laner. And you did see the fan vote as well. Over to Aimee, so supporting the conclusion from Frostgurren. Typically you would say that, but I think it's now just become a coin flip, and in traditional LPL fashion, has become a 50-50.
Now, something that we haven't really touched on just yet as we are now looking at them is that Jin Zhao's farm is actually still really good. And this is what has been effectively a 1v2 lane for how long now, since level 2 when he left and got the red buff. He took that red buff mid. Rhodes just been MIA the entire time. Yet there's only 6 CS between them, and that is about to crash under the turret. So AD carries are effectively even. That's incredible that Jin Zhao's even able to do something like that.
Sure. And when we were talking earlier, you had some question marks around the bottom lane and how this game may get exacerbated or like negatively through that bottom lane. And so far, they seem to be performing fine. And it's farming out. There's no massive kill differential.
And these two seem to be a little bit afraid of Ben 4, not knowing where he is and just knowing the dangers of Camille, I suppose. Erring on the side of caution, hiding underneath that turret. You can already see the respect that they're commanding IMA this early into the game. They're not even that far ahead, really. That's just the champions.
Yeah. I mean, most people don't see a lot of Camille, right? And don't really see it in the bot lane either. So in terms of... Oh, that's sad. Sad times for Ben 4. But you actually just don't know the respect to power level. So why not just respect it? Sit on the tower. You know you can farm there anyway, especially with the recall coming out. So that'll just be the game plan for that team. SOFM potentially caught out here by Rhodes and Ben 4 with Vina coming in as well from the mid lane. Mo, luckily, had to save his jungle at right place, right time. And he will be able to eat that fruit as well. Stay healthy. And Rhodes and Ben 4 will go back into their jungle. But you can see how much the supports are actually getting involved with their junglers. It's just a tag team effort from both teams.
You'd think they're tied together or something, and they're just unable to actually separate. And this is where we have to compliment Mo, being able to move around the rift now. Work with SOFM. The 2v2 is always the most dangerous feature of what IMA can actually offer, and they're matching it. And that's the biggest change that should be able to keep Snake well and truly within the realms of winning this game. And with the way that it started, SOFM's got that jungle experience advantage. When he hits 6, it could actually be a real big trouble point for IMA to deal with.
For sure, we'll have to keep an eye on that one. But going to the top lane, which I thought was going to be the focal point of this game, which apparently hasn't been until this point. Amazing J, Max Stacks on Flandre. Did not choose to ult there just for the damage, so he'll just probably regen most of that as he has picked up his first Dark Seal. There's the adaptation. We were theorizing in Champion Select. He has gone for the early tabbies there.
Yeah, instead of going for 3 Dark Seals and having more efficient potions, he's opted into the I'm not going to die route, which, believe it or not, makes sense. One thing that they were looking towards when we saw that last little tidbit of an engage was Amazing J trying to force out the ultimate from Flandre, perhaps get the resistances and the health regen, but because he's steadfast and doesn't use it, everything just slows down once again. As SOFM, you can see his evolve form.
Evolve is W, so we'll see that build this game.
There it is.
He's got max stacks, pops the ultimate. He knows he won't be able to follow after. He was just trying to burn the ghost and the ultimate, which he has done. And SOFM into the top lane. This is a bit of a scary gank, considering the health on Flandre.
Yeah, Amazing J
finds them on the outer ring of his Q, which he does. Will help him for a little bit, but he is still isolated. Flash comes out, there's the leap and the follow-up. Taste their fear. And the passive unseen threat for the kill for SOFM.
Yeah, at first thought, you'd expect that by not maxing out his Q, or evolving or rather, SOFM may not have had the kill threat, but the slow that comes out of that W being upwards of 80% is still enough to lock it down. It's SOFM mapping one step ahead of Ben 4, perhaps, wanting this blue buff.
Yeah, SOFM feeling pretty good about life, just taunting there, and Ben 4 will probably go into the top lane and collect this wave. Though he hasn't seen Kha'Zix in a while, so maybe he's on my blue buff. I'm going to walk into this bush, and up there's SOFM, and I just get to see him leap out of my jungle with my blue.
Yeah, and this is ridiculous now, because 2 levels ahead is the difference between junglers. Tank now being aggressive, but it's all because Kha'Zix is so large and he can afford to do this. Ben 4, not even level 6, doesn't have the kick, can't make plays, and as a result, everywhere's going to start to bleed and lose more and more. Unless Rhodes can work with him again, utilize that Camille-Lee Sin combo. That's where the Tahm Kench was coming into play, because if the Camille leaves, Tahm Kench can match.
I mean, you hit them now on the head. The teams, the laners and everyone on IMA just need to stop the bleeding right now. And some onus is on Rhodes. Maybe he can make a play happen, as he is still 1-1-0. Had that earlier side stone, so was able to maintain control over the bottom side. But even if he tag teams with Ben 4, there's no guarantee that it works out well for them with SOFM in the power position he's in currently. Ben 4 wants to get a blue buff in return, but not going to happen. Tank happily given that donation from his jungler. Mm-hmm. And Ben 4 is just kind of left to, just try and find his way in the world.
Play and walk away.
Yeah, that's not CS. You need CS. You need to do something. He's got level 6 now, so he has the possibility to try and find a gank. But finding out in the first place is easier said than done.
Yeah, it's not what we call an efficient invade. SOFM again mapping out one step ahead of his opponent in the jungle. We highlighted that jungle and it is actually starting to come to fruition as a teleport now bottom.
He's teleporting right behind Jin Zhao. He was also locked up with the Chain of Corruption, and that will just be an easy kill on the bottom lane. Maybe he was able to get one in return onto Mint.
He didn't even turn on his poison. No. There we go.
Yeah. Well, he didn't want to take the kill necessarily. Mint had got him locked up. I'm not even sure if he got an assist on that one. I believe he did, because he is currently on three. We'll just clear out the wave as a consolation prize and allow Mint to go back to base. So just a nice rotation there from Snake utilizing that TP. That will mean Amazing J gets a healthy bit of damage onto this tower. SOFM, you can see he's waiting in the wings, but there is no one to assist him. So he'll wait for Amazing J to back away before taking the wave himself.
I think SOFM's strong enough to deal with Amazing J as well in its entirety in a 1v1. Athena having the package does mean that after starts showing some respect, so the Kha'Zix won't stay for an extra wave. Darius opting to recall as he's just going to hang out now. And things will slow down, but again, more pressure being exerted by the Kha'Zix and absolutely nothing from the Lee Sin. He is practically invisible.
He has just picked up Warrior Enchant, though, and is still level 7 with his ultimate, so he has the possibility to, and the waves were all pushed, to be fair, so now he has a chance.
But he hasn't gone for boots. He's gone straight towards the Warrior's Enchant, which is about efficient damage output, but not being in the right place at the right time is effectively as something like mobility boots. So if he's there in advance, it'll be fine, but if he gets picked out first.
Oh, that damage from SOFM. He's got the reset damage on Q. Flash over the wall. Taste that fear. And that was just finding him in the jungle with a little bit of tag team effort from Tank.
Oh no, he's dancing.
SOFM, he knows he's ahead. He knows how much damage he's causing to Aimee. Look at all these pings coming down. Maybe something can work out for Aimee, but Rose getting chased out by SOFM. Last auto attack, flash away from Camille.
Ooh.
Piercing arrow just goes wide. And with no leap just yet on SOFM, that will not be the finish off on the support there.
Yeah, the crazy thing is Rhodes should actually be dead. Unfortunately, Mint missing that shot. And the pressure once again, SOFM's now invading, finding Ben 4. Always looking for the jungler because Snake plays slow, they play patient, and they let their jungler win the game for them. That's exactly how we're seeing this pan out so far.
This game is absurd. I mean, Amazing J did get his matchup, but he's just not been able to do enough in that top lane to warrant the Darius and actually just pick up the pieces that Ben 4 has kind of left him in this game. And I think that highlights a bigger issue. You know, we were talking about Ben 4 and talking about SOFM coming into the matchup, and Ben 4, he's a solo queue jungler. You know, will that come back to bite them later on?
Yes.
I think we said after a minute and a half, yes, that is indeed the case.
Ben 4 just saw that ward die, but he knows that he's able to stay around. He's committing towards a push and they're trying to siege now against Snake's 2v2 bottom lane. Flandre doesn't have teleport. And you can watch by the body language of Snake if the jungler's here.
Chain of Corruption will lock up Rogue, but there's no tower for protection anymore. Mo going to a Grey Hell. Tactical Sweep comes out, Ben forward, the defensive ultimate SOFM. This looks like a triple if I've ever seen one, especially with Tank coming in from the left-hand side. That teleport is going to take too long to come into fruition. Two fast kills to Snake, and Rogue has to limp away. Top lane, Flandre is going to bleed out. And that will be a kill in the top lane returned, but with the two in the bottom lane, that tower is dead to rights, and Athena too late to the party.
Yeah, a return kill doesn't really amount to anything for IMA, as they're still looking to pressure Athena off this, and he doesn't want to. They may not get it.
I'm going to go with they will get it.
They should.
Oh, that last creep, what an MVP, but it wasn't enough, so that defense from Athena was something I didn't even see coming. That was enough just from his missile barrage.
Yeah, it manages to hit most of the skill shots, push them away, but the advantage is still there for Snake. It was a counter gank, but it was a really obvious and easy counter gank to play for. Varus just has to hit the ult, and he did, because they're hitting a turret. Very difficult to actually miss that skill shot. And so now they get more kills, they snowball a little bit further. The only problem is Amazing J. And in saying that, it's still a singe. So whilst we watch how this happens, you can see he's just cancelling a teleport and suiciding.
Mm-hmm.
And such is the life of a singe player anyway. He was on his way through the minion wave, I'd no doubt to proxy regardless. And a death is just a scratch for a singe player.
It's a drop in the ocean when you look at the rest of the game as well, because what's a one kill Darius going to do with like a 20 CS farm lead when Kha'Zix can probably 1v1 him at this point as well? You know, it's so easy to get within that inner ring of Decimate, and then he's dead. So I really don't see what Aimee can do apart from just catching up across the
rest
of the map.
One thing we haven't hit is how easy it is for Kha'Zix to do the Drake. And now the reason that I don't think we've seen him go straight for it is that he leveled up the W. So he got the spikes instead of the Q. The isolated damage isn't there. So doing the Drake actually isn't as efficient, which is one of the reasons that people used to pick Kha'Zix, as they're about to probably pick the Caitlyn.
It's a lot of damage from that Tongue Lash. But it was just enough for him to back away. Bot Tower eventually finished off by Mint there, just picking up the pieces kind of off that initial push. And Tank will come back here into the mid lane. Lots of damage onto Jin Zhao, so pretty much all across the board. Oh, this could go pretty wrong. There's two players. There's another one in that Abyssal Voyage, and of all players, it was SOFM. Rode will back away. That's not the player you wanted to see come out of Mo.
No, not at all. So Jin Zhao now 0-3. Mo gets the ultimate off, and they're able to pick people, and again, the 2v2s starting to make more sense for Snake, as, I mean, I don't know why we're watching this at all, actually.
Well, it could be a kill. Nope.
Meanwhile, a turret goes down,
thing.
So
yeah,
in
that's
terms
the more
of
important
priority,
thing. Probably the mid lane tower, which opens up a lot of map advantage for Snake. However, watching Sin's map in the top lane was entertaining. Now it's Dragon over to Snake. There's nothing that Aimee can do, so it has to then just be reset, head back, place down these defensive wards, and see if they can maybe potentially make a pick, because that's in the territory they're in right now. And if you were just to join this game and you have just joined in, you're like, ah, 2k goal difference is not that big. And then you have a 4-1 and 3 Kha'Zix, you just picked up Ghostblade, and then you realize the problem that Aimee have.
There is a major problem. Not only that, Tank's completely finished his upgraded Hex Core. I believe that's going to be towards a Rylai's Crystal Scepter as well, which screams to me more utility. And that's the beauty of this composition, is they don't have to build full damage. The Kha'Zix doesn't have to evolve the Q. Flandre can just go, you know, tanky, utility, peel for the team. They can just have a lot of kite with the Rylai's Crystal Scepter if they want out of Tank. Mint's gone the cooldown reduction build as well, so they can get more ultimates off and just throw arrows from the distance. And that's really the direction that Snake are starting to take the pace of this game. It's get their items, accelerate their lead by just poking Aimee out, pushing them and forcing them to engage on you when it's not optimal, and then winning a fight how like that.
And we were talking about this on the analyst desk. Carl Snake are definitely a slower team, but they definitely are able to snowball leads. Like, this is a definitely a smarter game as well from Snake. It's like, okay, we got this lead, let's play it out.
Oh,
well,
boy.
Athena was just trying to recall. He has a family SOFM. Ooh. That's a lot of damage in return, though, with that exhaust coming out. So SOFM will not get his prey this time, but he did get both summoners. So it's still another advantage to Snake.
Yeah, definitely no complaints from SOFM. Just the ultimate used for invisibility to get out alive in return to summoner spells. He's a very happy Kha'Zix, so long as he survives the buff. And that's the start of the slow play, if you are actually Snake. They know that Corki has no summoners. They're waiting for perhaps a package if you are Aimee, but Snake don't want to fight on that package. They'd rather pick him off now and translate that. However, what are they translating it into at 18 minutes is the question, because the turrets aren't really that easy to take down unless they start grouping, which they are not. They're just laning.
And they couldn't even really take mid tower, which is the only one remaining. There's top tower down, bottom tower down, no Baron, no Dragon as well. So it's not like they can take mid tower with Tank standing there. Literally, Tank by himself can clear out a wave. So Aimee's options are very limited.
Yeah, but Snake could actually group themselves and just go towards the top lane out of turret. They just got the Drake that's not going to be dead for quite a while. Baron's not even in consideration, nor is the Rift Herald. And you'd expect that they just want to go towards that, get the free gold, siege, and snowball their items a little bit more. But they're playing this super slow. They are just laning and looking mid.
But it might work out for them. Abyssal Voyage used off the back of SOFM's damage onto Athena. There's a Disco Ball coming down onto Ben for, oh, the shock damage as well. Instantly destroy him as he's just trying to walk away. Rode body blocking for Athena. See if he can pick up a kill and return. But he is in the middle of no man's land. That is no longer their jungle. Rode will get away, and Athena the same thing with his life. But with that pick, now they can rotate stop lane. Pings are going down onto it, waves in the right place, and this should be an easy pickup for them.
Yeah, you'd expect that to be so. Once again, Tank starting to show up, has that Crystal Scepter completed, and this is the utility that it requires to pick people off. SOFM slow to start it, and Tank slow to finish it. Even the burst is there just because of how far ahead these two players actually are. And no matter how much damage Athena can provide, he's still going to be squishy. So you're right, the play's starting to come to fruition now. SOFM still stalking, even though he's been spotted.
Oh no. Around every corner is SOFM on this Kha'Zix. Rhodes wants to get away. Tactical sweep for a bit of health there as well. So he will get away to the rest of his team. A defense currently being put up by Athena and Dunjiao, which will keep the tower alive for now, but you may want to evacuate the premises as SOFM is stalking. Tank.
Not only that, Athena and Dunjiao are sharing farm, and Ben 4 push the mid lane out because they both have the wave clear on the top side of the map. The Lee Sin's effectively irrelevant unless he gets to, let's say, the 35-minute mark and has a couple of extra completed items.
Mm.
This Flandre is just having a giggle. Now, this is a big danger point for IMA unless they pull a rabbit out of a hat or a Darius out of a top lane. Like, they're not going to get anything.
Darius, he needs to be way more fed than this, because he's not even gotten his Black Lever yet. He's had to go straight towards that Spirit Visage, essentially just to deal with the Singe.
I agree, but level 16 should still be enough for Darius. I would imagine if he's just going to sit in the side lane and get levels. 16, having the ultimate reset, he should do an abundance of damage when he plays the 5-stack League of Legends game that Darius likes to do when he dunks everybody.
That's true, but that is usually without the added difficulty of a Kha'Zix one-shotting you in a team fight as soon as you step away from your team, so...
And a Singe fling and a Tahm Kench saving people that you're trying to hit. The Gravity Field and the Rylai's Crystal Scepter and the Kha'Zix peel. Like, Darius has got his work cut out for him, and I really do want to challenge putting the Darius top lane instead of just sticking with Camille and having a more conventional, perhaps, support. It wasn't really the problem, but it'd make things easier for them now.
It's an unfortunate game as well, because coming into this, it was like, all right, IMA picked up all these strong champions. This is a game that they can definitely win. This is not like a bad draft. It was all a ripple effect from that initial play from Ben 4. That Snake, to be fair, have capitalized on exceptionally well.
And I'm happy to, like, even allude towards that point. It's pretty simple as going as a five-man unit into the red buff and just warding it. Like, maybe it deters them from doing it, and you still get the red buff. Everyone's happy. But if you go in there as a five-man, place vision, see them in the bush before you queue over and die, things could be a lot easier for IMA, but instead they play hard mode and they're made pay.
Well, it's sad. In a different world, in a different reality, this game is going a lot better for IMA, and Ben 4 did not invade the jungle by himself. Mint potentially caught out here with Rhodes coming in nice from stun behind, but he just stays within the tactical sweep, so doesn't get the slowdown. Ben 4 going to jump in once again. Not sure if he necessarily wanted that kick to follow after. We'll use the defensive one there. Amazing Jay caught out, he's on the front lines. Big heal coming out, but he's knocked into his team. He'll instantly flash back to his tower. Athena now coming in there, but the Disco Ball is still putting down damage onto that top lane.
Good Rhodes damage.
Being followed after. Look at Flandre, he's going so quickly. Rhodes following him after, and he's just running away. He's just doing Singe things, allowing SOFM to assassinate Camille. Dunjiao walking away, Ben 4,
Flandre's
not
still
sure
going
why this is happening, but tank taken out, Athena coming up big, but now SOFM comes in to wipe up the floor. SOFM, he's taking everything, he takes away Crump, Mope, not sure why he appears on board. Oh, taken out by Ben 4, the flash, the tongue lash. What is this team fight? Amazing Jay, it's Darius time. There's Wandong, make it two. He's chasing after Mint, he's bleeding out, but he's trying to follow after, get this movement speed. The Zerot might actually kill him there. That's the ultimate. It's Darius time. Amazing Jay with the triple, and that's just turned the Darius online.
Yeah, he went back on a Black Cleaver and just came out and got three kills for his trouble. We said they needed a Darius from top lane. That's exactly what they get. But the reason that it's allowed to happen is because of overexertion from the Snake roster. Take the turret, take the one team fight. Don't try and push things harder than they need to be pushed. And this juvenile decision, honestly, from the side of Snake is what ends up being the downfall of them. Killing Athena here, this is fine. Flipping Ben 4 is still okay, but run. This is the point. Like, look at his health
back
when he Tahm Kench ults in.
This is where you back away.
Why would you jump there?
Now back away. Nope. Back away. Okay, here's amazing, and everything's just dead. Everyone's dead.
Even Mo's decision to come in and say, I'll save you, Mint, with my 10 health next to a Darius with his ultimate available. Everything's fine, except that it's all on fire now.
Oh, man.
There is 1,000 gold between them both after that, and look how far ahead Snake were and felt until this moment.
At the point in the team fight where it's like, what is going on? That's the point where you're Snake and you back away and don't run into the Darius. And a 4-1-0 Darius. Look how many items he got after the last, what, 2-3 minutes? He was just sat on the Spirit Visage. Now he's a Black Cleaver. He's almost on a third item. IMA have the priority on the map to go towards this dragon. And just on the flip of a dime, IMA are back in this game just because of that overextension, honestly, from Snake, which was disappointing.
Now look at the movements on the map.
They're still strong.
So IMA starting to feel like they've got a bit of tempo and we're pushing forwards. Of course, Snake still have a lot of damage. The question is, can they start to break this mid lane turret? One of the hardest turrets to break because they're against the Victor, and actually open the map up for themselves. Or will Snake still retain that control of some of his Rift, even though the items are now there for IMA? Because they're mostly just there on the top laner, and he can't always be here as Singed exists. Sometimes you have to acknowledge that, and it sucks, I know, but he does exist.
And Singed just chilling down in the bottom lane. I don't think he's put his Zerat portal down just yet. Oh, it looks like it's in the bottom lane. There it is. Yeah, I can see the
question
yeah.
mark ping.
Yep.
Not this again.
Well, Flandre's on his way up. Pops the scrying plant, and he'll just see Jinjiao walking to the top side. He's so fast for Flandre. He's out. He goes in, walks away, just saying hello to Aimee as he walks over to the Baron. But God, he walks so quickly with Righteous Glory. It's absurd.
Are you saying Bolt running down the mid lane at the moment? Of course, having those two items does give the availability to be able to catch people super easily, and the Rot Portal being highlighted also means that he can leave it in the bottom lane and come mid and make plays like that. So Singed is kind of at that breaking point where you'll see him start to teamfight more and more. And once he gets the Randuin's Omen, he is legitimately at that point where nobody can stop Singed from flinging a target. You may be able to change the target, but you don't get that much of a say. Someone's getting flung around.
Just have to hope it's not Ladarius going into your team when everyone's low. Yeah. That could be a potential initiate opportunity for Amazing J.
Amazing J would love it.
Yep. But 27 minutes in and out, Baron is definitely on the board as a possibility for the teams, and you can see that represented in the warding vision. Most of the priority has gone over to Aime as Snake kind of licking their wounds after that last fight, so they didn't really get a lot of those wards down.
I guess the big thing we're waiting for now is actually the Infinity Edge on Athena, as well as that level 16 point, because his ultimate has a 1-to-1 ratio in terms of damage when he hits level 16 explicitly, and before that is actually a little bit less. So the big rockets and the guaranteed crit will be there from him quite shortly, about 1500 gold, depending on how much he has in his pockets at the moment. And that's really a point where they can at least match the poke and potential siege that Snake have got the picks also relatively there for them, having a Lee Sin and Camille. As long as they have the damage to follow that up, it does make sense. Get Amazing J going with the Darius ult and everybody will start to fall down.
We're just building up to the tension is building up into a breaking point in this game.
Hey, he built it.
He's got it. He's got the Infinity Edge. And we'll just have to see him actually just hit someone now, because we will get to a standoff point very shortly. But that means that Snake are lying in wait.
And that's actually a really big deal for Athena, and like level 16 and Infinity Edge, he also has blue buff. You'll start to see more and more damage come out of him. As an example, that of course
great damage.
Does save a little bit, but he has the most expensive item build that you can purchase. So the fact that he's now got that means he'll be very relieved as his mid lane champion, and he's snowballing.
Rhodes almost caught up by SOFM, but that's Tank and Mo also arriving on the scene. Abyssal Void used. Hextech Ultimatum comes out, but so is Rhodes, so he'll back away.
No, Ben 4. I just felt like he was going to do it, but he shouldn't. Okay, so everyone lives. Rhodes, of course, having to use everything to get out. He didn't actually use the exhaust, weirdly enough, whilst he flashed and used his ultimate and redemption. But more pressure from... Wow. I was about to say pressure from Snake, and then Athena existed.
Yeah, apparently. I didn't see if Ben 4 hit the Q, because if he did, he was probably going to go in. Snake, Tank, almost caught out. Yeah. No, I think he was in range of Ben 4
deciding
to flash. Oh, Ben 4, he has been caught out, though. Slowed down by SOFM. He will flash away. Flandre, he's going in. He's flinging someone. It's going to be Athena. Oh, right into the Mega Adhesive for the kill for Snake. And that's an instant kill onto the ADC. Amazing J going to have to pull something massive. And he's going to be flung into the enemy team. And usual circumstances, this is what he wants. But we'll have to see how long he can stay alive. There's the first dunk. But unfortunately, he's too low to get anything else. That was almost the start of the Darius train.
Yeah, if that Q actually went off and he got the healing, it could have been the beginning of the end for Snake. But it's not enough, as IMA with two remaining members still may look to contest this. And in fact, I think they will be able to stop it. SOFM being very smart right now, and reserving his health bar so that he's there for the smite wall and not wasting it to the Baron that whittles down your health. But Benfor's here.
Hi, Benfor.
And they're taking the smite off, which is dangerous.
This is your time to shine. Lands the Q. Okay, they stop on Baron. He jumps over the wall. Can he get the execute Varus. Damage? Varus takes it out. As SOFM was focused on the jungler.
Neither of them smited, for the record.
Too close for comfort, I would say, for both teams. But Mint, the real MVP of this game. Yeah, you can see him on your screen. You can see not happiness or regret or anything. He's just kind of chilling. Yeah, Mint, the savior of Snake in that one. Good job.
It's like the end of a series, leaving you at a plot twist, but not actually having a resolution, you know? How did, like, in a smite war, neither of them get the one spell? Like, one job. They both had one job. Neither of them did it.
I have no idea. And I saw it as he was going over the wall. Benfor hits it, gets down to 900 HP, and both junglers look at it and then look at each other and start fighting. It's like, why?
If I kill him, I don't need to smite.
That's true. And Mint's just like, I'm just going to hit the Baron, guys. I'm just going to pick up the Baron.
Either way, they still get it, thankfully. So Snake, being the ones kicking it off, still secure it. Mint now throwing arrows sideways. I'm getting real confused. But another snowball, Drake.
Oh, when I look at the LPL, and like the later the game goes on and the more the players lose their mind, they're like just miniguns. They just like shoot out random projectiles and take the shotgun approach, and it's just like, something's hitting, I'm going to try and dodge, and it's just like, they just run at each other, like arms waving in the air, and then someone's going to win, and someone's going to lose. That is the LPL way. That's how we fight it out.
Oh, Varus
Mint jumping in. Chain of Corruption. He's dueling off against Athena, but he wasn't necessarily winning. Hextech ultimating keeps him in place. Flandre, he's running in. He's going somewhere, but it's SOFM wiping the floor of the entire team. Amazing J was thrown into the enemy lineup, but I mean, Jin Zhao and Athena were not healthy enough Flandre. To really help out. Flandre is going in. He's flipping Jin Zhao. Instant kill. Nothing to keep him on isolated for Snake to finish him off. And now they're onto this next tower. This has gone from bad to worse.
Yeah, they're able to push straight through. Amazing J can't find anything. And Athena gets engaged on early from the Varus ultimate. And so he doesn't really have the utility. In fact, he spent most of that fight running away from a Tahm Kench, who was, weirdly enough, ulting underneath the turret by himself. But the pressure was right, and it was in the right place. So the damage from Aimee was actually non-existent, whereas Snake had SOFM running rampant through the team, currently 10-2-7. This man's a monster.
Yeah, if he doesn't get MVP, I don't even know what's right with the world anymore. Like, SOFM, given that first kill, just snowballed out of control.
I'm tempted to say Flandre is deserving of it. In the last fight, when it was in the middle lane, like the big fight that just happened, he canceled the Valkyrie with his fling, like brought him all the way back. Like, that's the longest rake in history to pull him back. And so he died.
You're not wrong. I mean, that would be that's the play of the game, right? You know, that doesn't give you MVP. It means that was the play of the game.
You don't know how their MVPs work. Trust me, that was MVP.
I just don't. It doesn't feel right, you know, giving an MVP to a singed. I just, just straight up.
We did also just see SOFM evolving the R again. So he's being consistent now. We've seen him play Kha'Zix twice and evolve his spells in this order twice. So he's the only one of his kind, but it works for him. And so we let it happen. Whoa.
He's in, he's out.
He really is one of a kind.
He really is. SOFM turning up once again. Do you think he'll actually change up that build if he was with like a different composition that necessarily didn't have the damage?
Okay, so Rogue just flashed early, perhaps. He definitely didn't close the distance. He flashed pretty early, so he didn't get the full coverage. They didn't find what they were after. Snake found a turret. This is getting interesting real quick, Pulse.
This is a game, Rusty. This is a game. Benfor clearing out ward, lands the Q onto Mo. Okay, this is... All right, that's development from Benfor. He didn't follow up on that Q, so that was learning. But for now, it's just wait under this tower, see if they can get a fight on their terms, is the Aimee strategy. Amazing J now with the Guardian Angel. So he is still the one hurdle that Snake needs to jump over to win this game. But so far in these team fights, it's just been them picking up like Jin Zhao or Athena, and someone's dying before he's really able to get involved. So. The next fight will definitely decide it, but there's always the possibility for Darius to go off. That's always something in the back of your mind.
Yeah, neither carry actually having QSS, meaning they can't QSS flash out of the fling from the singed either. So Flandre actually starting to be the catalyst and one of the biggest deals within this game to give Snake some kind of engage, give SOFM some kind of entry in. and actually let them engage. But at the moment, and you can see from that control ward just being placed, the priority lies towards the Baron again. Like, they're really slowing the pace of this game down, playing with the minion waves, ensuring the river control in neutral areas and towards Aimee's blue side jungle is theirs, so they can secure the immediate and free objectives well in advance.
And this is what we want to see from Snake. They have their moments of them just, you know, the red mist descending and then just wanting to run into a fight. But outside of that, they are actually like placing down the vision, setting up for objectives, playing it smart, playing it slow. And that's what we want to see from Snake in terms of development for the team, especially with, you know, Mint and Mo in the bottom lane, away from the, I don't know, quote unquote, main roster of OQ, you know. So this is good from Snake. It's just those moments where they just, you know, lose all sense of League of Legends and how to play it and just run at Aimee.
Yeah, and the keyword's smart there also. So they're making the right decisions. They're making the patient play, which is what we said they were definitely were throughout the first week. But one control ward near the Baron area doesn't secure you a Baron. Secures you the outside area of it. So you have to watch how they place the rest of their vision. And at the moment, it is in that jungle and it's stopping Aimee from being able to even place a ward, which means that single control ward was fine. In fact, they replaced it with another deeper, more advanced control ward, because they can just walk over to that Baron or the Drake, depending on which they prefer, and the answer is Baron, and just take it. No response from Aimee unless they walk in blind.
That's the constant back and forth you can see on your screens right now, is Aimee trying to get some semblance of warding coverage, at least semi-close to the Baron, or just limiting the amount of pressure they have to face check.
I guess the counterplay here, though, is actually going straight to the Elder Drake, except Amazing J's recalling just ruined that. He was spotted recalling, so they can just fight.
Well, that was good and bad from Aimee. They burned the Lee ult as the kick away there to not get flung into the enemy team. Amazing J,
maybe
not the one
bad.
To get. Yeah, this could be very bad.
That's
the first kill goes on to Mo. Can Amazing J get rolling? He's got the Noxia might down. He rolls everyone into him.
Oh,
he's got
the
healing as well. He's looking for Darius to go off here. That's the second kill and the third as well. S2FM managing to finish off the enemy mid laner. But Amazing J is still alive with that Guardian Angel. Didn't get the heal. Trying to drop him down. S2FM does hit. But Jin Zhao still on the back lines. Rode zoning away the top laner. And that was a 4-for-1 favor of Aimee.
And it's Aimee starting the fight off straight towards the Baron buff and only Flandre alive. He has teleport, but I don't think he'll even consider trying to contest it. Just get rid of the minion waves and pray. Aimee pull, honestly, the rabbit out of that hat. And Snake should not have taken that fight. They should have looked towards the objectives. Called them patient, called them smart, and they throw it all away in one moment.
I think the biggest thing in that fight, Rusty, is I hope that we see it again, was Flandre. He didn't pull a rabbit out of his hat. He pulled a Darius, and he threw it into the rest of his team. And Darius was like, decimate. And then just killed everybody. So I want to see that one again, because it was so much focus on Amazing J that it was like, oh, there's a Darius on our team. The Jin Zhao was just wailing on them,
yeah.
And there was no attention on him at all.
No, definitely. Jin Zhao got free hits off. I'm pretty sure Athena, whilst he died, still did so much work at the start of it. Rode even did a lot of work, and Tank tried his absolute hardest to carry them. But it's not going to save you, because Mo is not playing like a Tahm Kench would play. He's actually playing like the support Camille would almost. Mm. He's in their face. He's very much frontline, and he's not protecting his teammates as well as he could be or should be.
I've actually seen very few defensive devours in team fights. I've seen it like as someone's almost about to get picked or, you know, roaming around
he's
the map.
He's doing it as a clutch thing.
Mm.
So instead of using it to
deny
avoid
damage,
he's using it to save somebody.
Yeah.
And like that's a common problem that a lot of people actually make, even as Thresh with lanterns and, you know, things like that.
KO ultimate.
Yeah,
as well.
KO ultimate's a big one of it. All the time you'll see them do it like that. And it's not the right way all the time, but in like you want to look like a superstar, that's a good way to do it.
Sure. But the problem is you have to cut the clip just as they're spat out again because they just instantly die.
Mm-hmm.
So you look good for half of it. Amazing J clearing out these blast cones.
They want the Elder.
In the jungle. I mean, they have priority over it. They have the vision control. Flandre's top lane. He does have that teleport.
No.
And the dragon is quite tanky, but Mo jumps in there. Amazing J, remember, he does not have his Guardian Angel, which is crucial.
They're straight
this
back
next
onto
fight.
It, though. No Varus ulti available, and that's the big engage tool they're actually using on the side of Snake. So they need Kha'Zix to go in and Singe to be there early, which is why that teleport's forced now, but they're going
for
the Elder.
Here's the disrupt, but Snake's onto it. They take away the Elder Dragon, and now Flandre's running in. This could be a good fight, or maybe the other way around, because Amazing J finds him. That'll be the save for Mo. That is a better one that we've been seeing so far. BenQ did land the Q, and now he's backing away. Tank hits him with the Disco Ball, and it's Flandre who's got off to
the side.
He's eaten up by Mo, but SOFM, he's still skirting around the outsides of the fight. Two kills are down so far in favor of Snake. And that'll be the end of that aggression. So despite Aimee picking up, or despite Snake picking up that dragon there, they were able to win that fight as well.
Yeah, Aimee, with the Baron buff, we're actually trying to initiate the entirety of this play, but Snake walk in when it has 3k and legitimately just smite it for themselves, which is really questionable. Of course, the eat from Tahm Kench is the big winner of this fight. We talked about Mo being perhaps the highlight hunter of his team now. Of course, saves the Camille from using the ultimate, and this is where they start to turn this around. The control. Again, SOFM on the flank with the spike. Rylai's from the ultimate of tank when he drops it down. And they're able to start picking people off one by one. But as a result of actually getting the Elder Drake, which was a mistake by Aimee not committing or by not leaving it sooner, that's allowed to happen.
So now, once again, the tempo swung, and it swung over the Snake. And that means they'll have the vision over the enemy jungle here in Aimee's top side, as well as the Baron, which did go down to Aimee. What? Wait, what? Yeah, Aimee now had the Baron, yes.
Yeah, the Baron buff lasts a little bit longer, of course, in the Elder, so they'll still have it, but it just runs out.
Yeah.
Because now we're at a complete reset, and that's a weird thing to say. There's still like a 7k gold lead for Snake, but past the 70k point, it means less and less as the amounts of money increase. And we start to see the full strength of team compositions in a game that, frankly, should never have happened.
Yeah, this it made sense up until the 20-minute mark, and then it stopped making sense for a good 15 minutes. And right now, you see the siege from Snake.
I mean, did you see 3 minutes in the game? It didn't make much sense.
I mean, it made... Okay, yeah. But in terms of how like Snake snowballed that lead and what didn't make sense, that was good. But I do agree, the first like 3 minutes was not great.
We saw a Camille support go to SOFM's blue buff after he got first blood and a red buff at his own red. And then Mo comes over and counter ganks.
Yep.
Real confusing start to the game, but it was Snake snowballing pretty well once they had the advantages and found their leads in the first place. And now really we're starting to see the team compositions. The weird one for me is Mint. He didn't go for the armor penetration or lethality Varus build, which you see on the later patches. Now note we are on 7.1, so it's not unexpected that he'd go towards this build. But Hurricane Blade of the Ruined King and an Essence Reaver just casually thrown in there isn't exactly efficient. It's okay, but by rushing the Essence Reaver, he didn't go towards the best item build. He's just going to be a tank shredder. And there's so much long-range poke and damage that ideally he should have actually just went for something to kill Jin Zhao and Athena to complement what SOFM was offering early.
Sure. Yeah, especially with, yeah, exactly, how he was playing. And right now SOFM has gone for, like, you know, a pretty heavy damage-orientated build, so he's doing a lot in his own right, but...
And it's okay if he kills Amazing J, right? Like, if he's able to take out the big target of Aimee, then Mint's doing a fantastic job. But it's unrealistic, given that Flandre's been flinging Amazing J into him consistently, getting him killed, am I right?
Well, hopefully he can stop doing that. Because of the way that this game has slowed down, again, talking about Amazing J, like, his Guardian Angel has come back up, so that is pretty big, and he's also hit full item build, picking up the Sterex, so it's actually very difficult to focus him out of the fight. That'll be something that Snake will have to try and play around in this next one, and almost certainly there will be a fight over this Baron, because it's gotten to the stage where it's leveling out in terms of items, and it's not so much whoever won the last fight, and, you know, there's no, like, Elder Dragon on right now, so there is the possibility for Aimee to push up. As you can see through their vision control, they've pretty much been uncontested while trying to get that.
We didn't really surmise the fact, but one awesome feature, I suppose, that Snake have gone towards and that Aimee have responded with is how the drafts work. Now, Snake, really good at fighting in the jungle, especially as we get evolves on the Kha'Zix, all the bush means that he's so hard to spot, so hard to monitor and actually take out. Their vision control in the jungle has been quite phenomenal up until Aimee team fought them in a lane. And then when they team fight in the lane, it looks better for Aimee because they're able to utilize the long stretch, not have any fog of war, and SOFM's able to sit on the sides, but he wasn't able to go in. And so we're seeing the ebb and flow effectively of what team compositions can do and how teams are responding to that.
I like the idea there from Snake. They had this breadcrumb trail of Voidlings coming out of that Zerat portal, and it's like, someone will come here, maybe, to clear this one away. But it was just a preemptive tactic, as they knew it was under a minute away from Baron. And with respawn time is kind of around that same time. If they got a pick, then it would allow them to take it, but not the case in this one. And now that spawn, Athena has just picked up his package. Mm-hmm. So it will be something that Snake do want to stall out. And I may kind of want to fight a little bit earlier to use this package.
I mean, by having the package, they should want to fight, but by pushing into Snake now that they're starting to secure pressure, like, that was their window just then. Mm. The window's gone. Amazing J still pushing the bottom lane, trying to control the wave. So they've got this really confusing predicament of, I want to group now, I want to fight with the package now, but Darius also needs to set up a slow push in the bottom side of the map, then maybe rotate and group with the team, where Snake can just move Flandre over and start working it right now. The package won't get used.
Just by Flandre being there, you actually saw the positioning of Aimee. They had to back away, and that meant they lost a lot of ground. And look how fast the Baron died. That was maybe less than 5 seconds with all of that focus damage from Snake. And that was pretty much just from Flandre rotating up. They knew that they couldn't get within aggro distance of him, just running at them. So,
an Amazing Jay just playing wasn't there early enough. Yeah. For that to be prevented in any way. Two Mountain Drakes and all of the damage that the composition has on the side of Snake, a Kha'Zix and a Varus with Blade of the Ruined King, even Victor going Lichbane, like, that was going to die in 5 seconds flat. And I guess they just didn't respect it enough, or they didn't really see fit to get in there and had no choice but to concede.
That means Flandre can go back to his natural habitat of bot lane, and SOFM almost caught out here. He is completely caught. Jumps out of the wall! Headsec ultimatum! What a play from Rode! Finding the enemy jungler, keeping him down, and that's bought them so much time.
When he gets the R button off, there is no escape. So Camille manages to counter the Kha'Zix, so has a flash after that jump available anyway. Just gets completely pulled back in. And this is the greed that we see from SOFM, the style of me. Mm-hmm. It's farming a lot. And you don't really need to farm a lot when you've got a Baron and pretty much a full build. You can just calm down a little bit.
Yeah.
Like, the red buff wasn't going to win you the game. Unfortunately, tendencies get him.
It was that, and getting on these solo missions and playing the hero, you know, when you're like 11-3-8, you know, just like, I can do anything.
He bought a Tiamat, and then he sold it, and then he bought a Randuin's Omen. SOFM's made a decision. The decision is that he needs to be a bit tankier now.
Oh, that's funny. Well, I mean, you know, it's him evolving. It feels a little bit better than him just going for raw damage once again.
But feel like Golden State Warriors, honestly. They were 3-1 up. Now they're cooking it.
I mean, I don't know. I don't know what's going on. But Snake, they have a little bit left on their Baron, but they haven't really been able to use it and won't be able to use it simply from that play from Aimee catching SOFM out in that jungle, which means that the map resets. And now we're looking towards Elder Dragon. And from what I felt was a very smart game, we used that word a lot earlier onto the game from Snake, there's evolved into a game that is very much just about these singular objectives from both teams. And it can't be from anything else. That's how the game has evolved. And 47 minutes into this one, a game that probably should have ended 25 minutes earlier, this is where we find ourselves.
We're definitely getting kill hungry from both of these teams. Ben 4. No, you don't.
He's out. He's
Everyone
good.
Calm down. Splendre's actually found Jinjiao.
Splendre! He's going to flip Jinjiao into the wall.
This is awkward.
That's not an ally.
Where are you going? He's...
Oh no! He's on the Flandre. Oh, he'll jump away. He didn't get him in the Valkyrie this time around, but that will be the tower going down. Rode into the right. Hextech ultimatum coming out onto Mo. Not quite the target he was really looking for, but tower is dead, so I guess target acquired and target eliminated from stake.
Yeah, unfortunately, that tower just gives them a tiny bit more pressure on Summoner's Rift that doesn't amount to anything.
Whoop!
This
it's
does
Mo going in, and this could be a very good fight for Aimee. It's just amazing. Jay, let's see if he can find a. You know, an apprehend onto
really
somebody.
Good inside track though here, Pulse, having all the poke available and control with the Caitlyn traps. Forces recalls.
Yep, they can't take the express route into their middle lane. Chain of Corruption onto Rode, okay. That was used at the very start of that engagement, if you remember. But
teleport
here comes
in.
The TP from...
All right.
It's Flandre running around in circles.
He's slowing them all down with his red eyes.
He is. And that poison trail will add up in damage.
It's actually a pretty big deal.
I mean, this is the problem that they have to deal with, and they have turned onto Flandre. They will eliminate him immediately. Amazing J did not get anyone with that apprehend. So for now, they'll back off. But that was the decision that had to be made. And you can see his corpse, his sad, singed corpse in the mid lane.
He didn't necessarily need to teleport there. There was a top lane turret that he should have defended, and instead the turret goes down. So I'm actually get two turrets for their troubles and a kill. Onto the Singe, meaning the Elder Drake should actually be theirs, SOFM's on the top side of the map. The things that just happened.
Like, I'll be honest, Rusty, I don't think I've seen League of Legends like this at all, ever. I don't think I've ever casted a game like this, where you have a Singed TPing in behind them and doing, like, I don't know if you've watched The Flash, but when he's just, like, running around the target super quickly trying to contain them, pretty much what what Flandre was trying to do there.
He was making a poison arena, yeah.
But he got but he got caught, and he died. But he'll be back up soon, so don't worry, viewers. He'll be back to once again rain havoc on IMA.
But that's three concurrent turrets that have dropped now because of this one play. Almost finding a pick in the middle lane just causes absolute chaos within the Snake comms. And having the package means that makes it four.
Man, that was a pretty big power play in terms of just like everything that IMA just got.
The map anti-Baron
pressure,
power
gold.
Play, yeah.
Yeah, that's like the worst Baron play in history from Snake right there. And again, we're in this situation where it comes down to these objectives. We're rapidly approaching. One team fight will decide the game. And with those towers down, that's also put it in IMA's court. Because often you get to these scenarios where it's just like, one team fight, game ends. But for one team, because there's so many towers available, or still up for them. But because the towers are just taken out, now IMA have that shot as well. So it actually just becomes this shootout.
It was kind of funny that at 15 minutes in the game, we said, you know, Ben Four's waiting for the 35-minute mark to be relevant. Well, he's got his Guardian Angel. He's got his Warmogs. He's definitely relevant.
Yeah, we were a couple minutes off, but at 51 minutes, Ben Four has turned online.
Oh, he's been around for a while. I'll stick with 35, but it's just crazy to think that he's even in game.
Yeah, I guess so, but he hasn't, like, done a lot of Lee Sin things, which is, you know, getting those insects and making
them
happen.
Not his full build.
He's done, yeah, he has room to grow. He still has room to scale. But until we actually see Ben Four make that highlight moment happen, I will say that that will be when he turns online. And that's very different from what we were seeing from Ben Four anyway, the first time we saw him in week one.
Yeah, definitely. Ben Four kind of showed some early game jitters, perhaps got exploited by SOFM, and the smart jungling that SOFM's able to provide kind of put the tempo on them and threw pressure down. Now, they do still have Singed, who can engage, weirdly enough, by running at you extremely quickly. And so while the Elder Dragon exists, perhaps he may not, but the second the Elder Dragon buff dies, which is roughly 20 seconds at most, you may see a Singed run at you super quickly.
All right, so I'm going to shoot a question towards you, Rusty, and you may not have much time to answer it. which team is actually stronger in terms of teamfight right now? Because you have a Caitlyn who's pretty much full item build versus a build that is not like a traditional ADC build on the side of Mint.
Yeah, I actually would wager that I may have a better team fighting comp at the moment, but it's all dependent on how they play it out. The chains connect, or if it starts like this.
There's the flank onto Rogue. The rest of the team will come in beside him to try and protect him. SOFM zones away. Hextech ultimating, keeping him in place. Ben Four dropping low, but he's got the Guardian Angel. Safeguard.
Amazing
will keep him alive. Amazing Jays into the enemy team. But the rest of the team is not there to support him just yet. He'll go down to the Guardian Angel, and he is such a crux of this composition that the team needs to defend him. Big heal out from the Decimate, but not enough stacks. And IMA, that may have been the opportunity needed just to try and defend him.
So it might actually just result in a Baron, the second pick. They actually stopped recalls. This could be really bad for IMA.
The close in around this moat. Moat will eat up that one target. Athena being chased down. Flandre, he's pretty fast. He needs this flank to happen. Flash away. Oh. But he's slowed down. Lots of damage in return, but Rote is going to be flung into the enemy team. That will mean he'll take the trip out with his Flash,
Jinjiao,
and Ben Four going on an adventure apparently by themselves. It's now turned into a 2v2 with the traps coming down. SOFM and Tank,
bottom.
I would definitely put the onus on them to win this 2v2. Mo and Mint also in their own 2v2 in the river. Jinjiao, they're going for the 100 meter sprint. Mo and Mint will turn onto Rogue. Lots of damage coming through with a laser for the finish off. Mint trying to
get
the kill.
They are going bottom, like I said. What? They have to defend bottom now instead of Baron?
They ran from the blue buff and now they're in bottom lane. And Flandre is just running around them. He's going to try and cut them off with his poison. He's actually doing it fairly effectively as SOFM is waiting in the wings. He even taunted them. What an evil man. Flandre tossing Jinjiao into the rest of his allies, and here comes the collapse. Ben Four dropping down,
an amazing Jay's alive
behind him.
Like,
comes
that's where
back
we're at.
Up. See you later, nerd. 3-0, Snake with this pick off, and maybe they'll finish the game. I just don't know, Rusty.
There's a long time without Jinjiao and Ben Four alive. You'd expect perhaps they go towards bottom, but Flandre's just decided
he's going
to say hello and not actually join his team bottom. Perhaps Snake now decide that Baron's the better option. Amazing J did respawn throughout all of that. Like, they survived for long enough that Amazing J's 70-second death timer came back. So that's how long they were fighting for.
I guess that was the plan. We don't defend him in the team fight, but we just stall them for long enough for him to respawn. That is the play here. Snake, take out this bottom inhib. Flandu running after Fina, has to burn the package.
20 seconds on Jin Zhao. They are looking for
wave. Blocking out the chain of corruption. Good apprehend. Lands the Q. He needs the Sax to come up here. Hextech ultimatum onto S2FM. Amazing Jay. He needs to get these resets rolling because one of his allies has just dropped down. There's the second one. Lots of low health targets on Snake. Jin Zhao has got less than 10 seconds remaining. First tower has dropped.
Jin Zhao's alive.
Look at the Earth Dragon. Look how much damage it's dealing for them. Amazing Jay into the team, flung back towards his Nexus. And it's S2FM using all of that damage to finish it off. And after that 50-minute game, S2FM finish off for Snake. Snake, take it 1-0 over iMay.
I have no idea what just happened. I honestly have no idea what just happened. That was really confusing. And there was a lot of messy decisions out of both of the teams. But in the end, Snake, they do get it. They started with it. They dropped it a lot, fumbled it, and they picked it back up in the end.
A win is a win, Rusty. And we have been talking for a good 50, 55 minutes. And Froskuren has now rejoined us to offer her insight. So what do you think?
It's okay. I'm here to help you out, Rusty. First thoughts, I'm actually quite impressed with a lot of things that happened this game, and I'm very disappointed with just as many things that happened this game. Let's kind of talk about the cool shit first. Let's get in there.
Let's do it.
So what was really cool is the Camille support pick, and specifically how it interacted with Singed. So a big problem was is that the game seemed to really stall out, kind of around that 14-minute to 23-minute mark. You guys are like, okay, SOFM is super far ahead on this cause. You know, Aimee, they completely botched the level one, but now they can't really do anything. And the problem is that sieging into Caitlyn Corki, especially with that composition, speaking of which, Raz, yeah, look at that graphic, Raz. Darius, no. Corki, yes. Athena played like a god.
He definitely did in that game. We were talking about like the Caitlyn and how she went for that traditional ADC build, but actually Varus in terms of poke was just doing so much with that Blade of the Rune King onto those tanks.
But I just want to quickly touch back to the Corki. Sieging into Caitlyn Corki, especially as Snake's composition, is incredibly difficult. And the problem was is that pre-21 minutes, Singed had no armor. He was against Darius, and he rushed MR, actually, and he went for his Rot Portal. As soon as the Rot Portal came online, that's when the initial dive came through. Mm-hmm. And remember that big team fight where Snake overreached. So they're like, we don't have any armor, we can't dive, we have to stall this one out until we can actually start sieging up these towers. As soon as Singed gets it, immediately Camille ulted. And that was really cool, is when Camille could lock Singed around so he would never be able to engage. And that's what was really clever about the composition, is that Aimee were so smart knowing that as long as this Camille ult goes on Singed, we'll automatically win the team fight because Corki will just destroy them and they have no engagement, but anytime the Camille ult didn't go on Singed, they automatically lost.
Yeah, pretty much that's how it went. You talked about how difficult it was to siege against them, but how much of that was actually just facilitated by the fact that Snake just ran into them and gifted Darius a million kills?
So that was the other big thing. So Snake were intelligent knowing that they couldn't siege into the Corki and Caitlyn until they had the armor when they could look for the dive at 21 minutes. But the problem was is then the execution error came in. So from theoretically, like, it's smart. Snake, you're doing the right thing. You understand that you need to have your itemization before you're strong, like identifying where your power points are. But then they overreached, and then they fed all of those kills into Darius, and then it stalled out the game again. And then even at 35 minutes, you saw that it was still incredibly difficult to siege into Aimee with that Caitlyn Corki comp.
It makes sense, right, that it's hard to siege into a Corki, but it's just as hard to siege the other way because they built the exact same team composition. So it was a super Baron reliant game, which is where it does start to, you know, drag out more and more. The game went super long because Baron was such a big deal. At the end of the day, Snake with such a big lead, instead of going for the Baron, which is the breaking point of being able to siege into that Corki, they went for a fight and lost the fight. They took a needless, risky decision where they could have actually just went for an objective.
But it also makes sense that Snake would be very risky, because I agree with you. Like, there were so many objectives for the Baron, for the Elder Dragon, for these team fights where you're like, that's not quite off. You know, individual decision making, SOFM getting caught out when he tries to make that escape over the dragon pick, because he's like, have Baron buff, might as well farm red, SOFM things. But it's just like, Snake are a brand new team.
Like that too.
Yeah. Snake are like a brand new team with this iteration of the roster. You know, they have Mint and Mo. Those, they've never played on that roster before. SOFM has a language barrier there. You know, Flandre has said that it's difficult to communicate with that jungler. So Flandre and Tank are your only remaining core members. You look across at Aimee, you know, 47, 55 minutes into the game, suddenly Aimee start making a comeback and they start looking really clean because the only new member that they're playing around is their jungler.
And let's, like, one step further, Flandre, we have heard, it, like, does not say he talks. He literally says two words at most when he's looking at his top laner. He's similar to Impact in that respect. Literally says top dead, I think, instead of top die. Like, that's the major difference between the two. And Tank was also a one-split addition to the team last year. He hasn't been here for long enough, so it's really hard to say how their communication works.
I actually 100% agree with this MVP. The team fight that finally broke it up open for Snake, because again, a lot of individual decision making that really delayed them, put them behind, was that last team fight around the mid lane. Tank zoned out Corki and I think two other members. It might have been Jin Zhao and the support with his
Gravity Field.
Exactly, his Gravity Field, and then his Chaos Storm to chase them away. He was so good at target priority, so definite the strong standout member there to carry them over the finish line.
I know I definitely gave it to SOFM 30 minutes into the game, but then it like devolved rapidly, and you know, we had SOFM just going into the jungle, taking away their red, and just instantly dying, and that was created such a big rift in that game, you know. So yeah, Tank definitely deserving it. Heading into game two though, do there need to be adaptations from the team? I'm not sure we're gonna see a Darius Singe top lane again, so we will see a change, but in terms of how they were playing, I felt like a lot of it was execution and in-game versus the draft.
I'd agree with that. I think also, despite the fact that Snake won, I don't think that they were the better team there. If IMA hadn't botched their level one entirely, again, based off their brand new junglers, you know, running in blind, like that was an awful play, but they had to absorb so much of that through the early game, and IMA did a fantastic job absorbing a lot of that. And yes, it still was Snake's mistake of kind of overreaching, but IMA punished them at every turn. Like, from a defensive standpoint, hats off to IMA to get themselves back into the game and to try to take it.
Yeah, and I think we even highlight the level one even further. It's something that doesn't necessarily need to happen. We look at the EU LCS, they have pretty intricate level ones. They try and make some cool things happen, for better or worse, but he just brute forced the red buff, like, on the assumption that perhaps he wasn't there. Like, maybe he started blue buff because nobody does that in competitive. Like, it's a team decision. Like, they could go in as five, place wards. We said this in the game. Yep. Like, there are things that they can do to make this better, to not have what happened happen.
And then once they were there, like, well, we can't leave because obviously if I back out now, I lose everything. So he was like all in.
So does the focus need to change in terms of the draft? Because, I mean, we saw Camille first pick, which was something that we don't typically see. And that harkens back to what we were saying at the start of the day. We're not going to get an answer to that question, but we may after the break because we're heading to break. So we'll see you in just a few minutes. But when we get back, it'll be time for game two between IMA and Snake.